beginners out there to invest in.
Like, what should be my first cool photographer look?
Yeah, you can manually adjust the focus. What a DSLR camera is about, you can play with a lot of...
Okay.
Not everything will be as per your plan. Hi everyone, hello.
Hello everyone, I'm Varun Iyer.
I'm Radhika.
From Photograph IS, and today we are going to touch upon some basic questions which any photographer, beginner photographer specifically, might have, or any photography enthusiast might have.
In order to make this more of a discussion and an interactive session, I'll be posing all the basic questions which we may have as a beginner or someone who is new to photography. So I'll be asking certain questions, basic questions, and Varun will be responding to them.
Yeah.
So yeah, I'll start away.
Yeah.
Okay. So yeah, I have a pretty decent phone.
Okay.
So I'll say I have an iPhone. So it takes really good pictures. I mean, I'm quite satisfied with it. Why should I go for a DSLR DSLR camera, to start with my photography journey?
Many phones today is well equipped with good camera. Okay, for example, the iPhone. Many people have appreciated it, and I myself am surprised by the clarity and the kind of photography
yeah.
that can be done with iPhone. But I personally believe that the photographs which is taken from a DSLR has much more clarity and. In a DSLR, the thing is that you can play with a lot of things. You can experiment and try your photography skills with a DSLR camera. And also, one thing which I find which is different from iPhone is that the DSLR has a good depth of field. So this is now a technical thing, okay? So that depth of field is actually when the subject is properly focused and the background and the foreground is not in focus. So that gives a very much a 3D effect to the picture. So I find that in a DSLR that works much better than a normal phone. Okay, and also in a DSLR, the thing is, as I mentioned before, there are various modes that you can work with. There's a manual mode, there's an aperture mode, there are shutter priority mode, etc. Again, this would be a little bit on a technical side. So with which you can experiment your photography skills, and these are there in the phones as well, but. In a DSLR, it comes very handy. There are various buttons with which you can maneuver the settings, etc. So it's more convenient in a DSLR.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what I find better in a DSLR.
Yes, it also gives you that cool photographer look.
Yeah, that's very important.
Yeah, so when you're clicking nice pictures and all. Okay, I love travel, and I like to, if I want to capture some of my memories or something, what should be my first, 2-3 things that I need to check, the basic features that I need to check when I'm buying a DSLR camera?
The basic, so you're talking about the basic features you're talking
basic
about?
Basic features I should look for when I'm purchasing a
So camera. Basically, talking about the basic features which any photographer or any beginner photographer should be aware of while purchasing a camera is, or who has bought a DSLR camera, is about the types of focuses that it has. For example, there is a manual focus where you can manually adjust the focus of the subject, etc. The second is an autofocus. Okay, the autofocus has two kinds of focuses. In a layman's language, I would tell the one is for a moving object where the focus is locked on a subject, and the as the subject moves, the focus also shifts. And there is autofocus for a stationary subject. And so the first one is called the autofocus continuous because it's for a moving object, and the second one is the autofocus single. Okay.
Okay, this is getting a bit.
I have to flaunt my photography skills as well.
Sure.
And as I had mentioned before, the different kinds of modes. Okay, there's a manual mode. Okay, in the DSLR, which helps you play with the aperture, the shutter speed, the ISO. Again, this is a kind of a different topic and a technical topic to talk
about.
Make
a different
view. Yeah. So there's the manual mode, then there's shutter priority mode, then there's aperture priority mode. So you need to research on all these things and know about it and work on these kind of modes so that you can experiment your photography skills and you can build your way from there.
So what about the lens? Which one should I buy?
The lens is a very big factor as well while purchasing. So for example, there are different types of lenses. Like for a landscape photography, you should have a wide lens with a 18mm or like a 8mm is a fisheye lens, which you can see in a GoPro footage as well. So wherein the sides of this thing is warped, it is, even if you bring that lens too close to you, you can view the entire background. So that is one kind of lens that is used for landscape photography. And if you're into fashion and lifestyle, shooting for weddings, etc., where you need to shoot candid photos, etc. So for that, you can use a prime lens, which is a 35mm or a 70mm or a 50mm. Prime lens.
To sum up, we spoke about the different types of lenses, the focal length which you need to plan according to which you want to buy, the different modes and the focus, different types of focus. Okay. So fine, I have bought my first DSLR camera.
Okay.
So after that, any particular like accessories or something that you know I need to have or something which you know will enhance my quality of work or will you know help the camera to be you know in a better state.
Okay. So I would say to buy a proper camera bag, which is like a backpack. Okay. So the bag which you get with the camera is like a sling kind of a bag. Okay. And it has limited storage. Like you can store up to 1 to 2 lens with the camera body, etc. But it above that it gets too cramped. Okay. So there is a separate backpack for a camera which is very convenient, where there is a separate section for the camera body, different kinds of lenses, for batteries, SD cards, etc. So I really recommend the beginners out there to invest in that kind of a bag. Okay. And the second is, many of them might say that it's not required, but I would recommend to buy a tripod because it brings stability to your photographs or footages that you take. With a tripod you can experiment time lapses, you can do various experiments with the tripod, etc. So that is one thing. The other thing which is really important is to carry extra batteries. Okay. In the start, while you're practicing photography, it might seem it's not very important and not required, but as you get into full-time photography and start to go shoot more frequently, you will want to have like extra batteries with yourself. So that is very important.
Okay, so now I have all these accessories, I have a good camera. Okay, now I'm like out at you know some place, some beautiful place. Everything around is really beautiful. So like what should I do? Like should I click everything around because everything is so beautiful. So how to have that perfect you know like the capture, you know, how to like focus and compose a nice
Interesting question. So I would say that having a good capture comes through practice. Okay. In the start, when I started photography, I myself, as you mentioned, I find everything outside very beautiful and very pleasing to the eyes, etc. But when you start photography, in the start it might be very confusing what to shoot, what not to shoot. There are certain things which are very pleasing to the eyes, but in a photograph it does not appears so or does not come that way. At the same time, there are certain things which comes very well in a photograph, but it's not noticed to the human eye. So actually you need to go out there, start shooting to understand what you like to shoot, etc. You need to take a lot of photographs in the start, understand what do you like, what you do not like, etc. And then after practice and experience, you will get to know what kind of photography or the pictures you like to shoot. So, and also there's one more thing is composition as a thing is very important in a photograph. For example, this is the mouse that we have. For shooting this mouse, it's not only about taking keeping it in the center and taking a picture of it. It's not about that.
Okay.
It's about creating an environment, okay? For example, I have kept this mouse over here. You need to have something on the foreground, something in the foreground, and create an environment.
So just to clarify, the object is here, the background is behind the object, and the foreground is before the object.
So basically, you need to create that environment around the product to give that. You can actually create emotions from a picture by creating that environment, okay? So that is very important. This I am talking about indoor photography, but if you go to outdoor, if there is any person you want to click, you keep the person in focus and also show the background behind, okay? So that you create an environment around.
So an emotion.
So for example, you get to know many photographs themselves show a lot of story. In the picture, okay? So that is very much important to convey the story to the audience.
Okay.
So composition is a very big part in
Can you show an example, like how do you compose in an outdoor kind of a scenario? Because I can understand in an indoor kind of a scenario, it's very easy. You can keep stuff and, you know, however you want to arrange it, you can make it look aesthetic, you can have the proper lighting, etc. But in an outdoor scenario, it's very difficult. The lighting is not in your hand.
I mean,
it depends on the weather and whether it's cloudy or, you know, whatever. And not everything will be as per your plan. I mean, there could be some shadow or, you know, it's not as per your plan. You want some light to be there on some part, but it may not be there.
Yeah, so, highlighting on that point, patience is very much required when you're in a natural background.
Okay.
You have to, there are many wildlife photographers or many landscape photographers who have to wait for 6 to 8 hours for that perfect capture, or sometimes they cannot capture the picture that they want. They have to visit that place twice, thrice to have that proper and the perfect capture that they have in mind. So patience is very important while doing the photography.
Can you show me an example? I mean.
Talking about the example you were highlighting upon, we have a photograph from Vietnam where Radhika is actually walking in a place called Mui Ne, and wherein it's a white sand desert. Okay, so
I didn't know he was clicking that picture.
She didn't know. So I had to wait for her to go till that place, and I can click that moment. So you guys can see the trails of the buggy car, okay, moving across the paths of her. So I wanted her to be in the center of the frame with the trails meeting up at a point, and so that kind of a composition I had to think about. So there's a lot of thought process that goes behind creating a proper.
And it's not that it was planned. It just happened at that time that he saw that those two, you know, that paths tracks matching, as you can see in that image. And it was like at that point, we'll have a picture click when she's there in the center. So yeah, coming to the main question, which DSLR camera should I buy? I mean, which brand and which, you know, what is the product code or something like
that? So for beginners, I would recommend the base model of, I'll mention all the three brands because it's not a sponsored video. So in Nikon, I would say D3200, 3300. In Sony, you can go with Alpha 5100. It's on a bit higher side in terms of price, but it's a good camera for starters. And the third is a Canon, where you can go for the D5100. So these are all base models which you can start with, okay? And then once you are fully confident with the kind of photos that you take, and you are fully confident about taking this up as a career going ahead, or if you want to shoot it even for passion as well, you can upgrade. You can go for higher models.
Understood. So yeah, that was very informative.
Thank you.
So yeah, in case like I have missed out on certain questions or something, you can mention that in the comments, or you can DM to us on our Instagram handle.
So as a practice, we will so any questions that interesting questions or comments that you will post in the comment section below, we will be addressing or answering that in the next video. So let your comments keep coming.
And in one of our upcoming videos, we are also planning to have like a complete dissection of a Nikon D3200 camera, and actually with all the features and all the buttons and all whatever is there in that camera, we'll be actually doing a complete dissection of that. So yeah, stay tuned for that also.
Hope you guys like the video. Please like, share and subscribe to the channel, and we'll be coming in And meet you all until the next video. Take care. Bye.
Bye.